Hello, in this video I would like to give you some additional information to the lecture, some pictures and further explanations, hopefully also useful for you to understand the background behind these amazing effects which we have discussed during the lecture. First of all, again, some important informations about the lecture itself. As many of you have realized, videos are now online on YouTube and linked also into Moodle. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me directly. Just send me an email and I can arrange a Zoom meeting with you. In the first picture, I would like to show you the effect of polarized light. First of all, how can we polarize light in general? We can use a polarizing foil. I've discussed that in the lecture. Or using the Brewster angle, where one component of light is actually not reflected at all. Scattering on water molecules also polarizes light, and that's actually done, for example, in clouds in the sky. And we can use nonlinear optical crystals, where one component of light is actually partly suppressed. In this picture, you see actually a car, and look at the windscreen. In the first case, left-hand side, you see unpolarized photography taken with no polarization filter, so unpolarized, and part of the sky is actually reflected. You can see part of the sky in the windscreen as reflection. Right side, here a linear polarizer was used in front of the camera, and now you can perfectly look into the car. The reflection from the sky is completely absent. So that's a nice way to demonstrate polarization of light. We have discussed optical images, and here, just as an inset, photography, optical cameras. Here's actually a camera from the 1934, pretty old Leica camera. I've chosen that because we took a neutron image of this. So neutrons are particles, but also have wave properties, as discussed in the lecture, de Broglie wavelength. With neutrons, you can take pictures equivalent to X-ray pictures. However, the contrast is different. For example, lead is perfectly invisible for neutrons, whereas hydrogen light atoms are strongly neutron scattering. So that's why you can see actually through the steel frame of that camera, and you see the inner parts. Most important, the lens, because that's what we have discussed in the lecture. Here's the side view of the camera, and now you can nicely see the lenses here. Side detail, in those years they used borinated glass, and boron is strongly neutron absorbing. This is why the lenses are pitch black. But if you have a closer look, the second lens, the thicker lens, has actually two slightly different gray shades. And here, two different types of glasses are glued together. And the trick here is to compensate for chromatic mistakes. That can be nicely seen here. Next slides are just a side note for you, just to let you know that these old cameras still work perfectly. So I just took these photos 2 years ago on that camera. Here the Sydney Opera House. And oops, some impressions from the Queen Victoria building. So even so that this camera is 85 years old, just produces beautiful pictures. Optical resolution and the Rayleigh criterion. that defines the limitation of the resolution of, for example, a microscope or a telescope. The limitation of optical resolution is the angular separation of two point sources, which means when the direct maximum of the second point source falls into the first diffraction minimum of the first point source. And for circular aperture, the following equation is given. Sine theta is 1.22 lambda over d. And theta is the angular resolution. For example, if you look into the sky, the separation between two stars. D would be the size of the mirror of the telescope. The picture below actually demonstrates that. So from left to right on the left side, condition where we can still resolve two points. So the diffraction maximum of the second point source is further away from the minimum of the first source. And you see nicely two peaks in total. Rayleigh criterion, exactly this condition is fulfilled, and you see that there are still two maxima which can be observed. If we move them a bit closer together, they, let's call it, smear out, and the total resulting image is just one single peak. You can't resolve the two different objects anymore. So how can we now overcome that problem? We can actually build larger and larger and larger telescope mirrors. And that's a question to you now. What do you think is the largest diameter of a telescope at the moment? 5 meters, 15 meters, or even much larger than that? So what do you think? Well, the answer is, if you combine various telescope dishes, you can achieve a radius far beyond that. And here are some pictures from the currently built Australian Square Kilometer Array. First part here was completed already in 2012, but the second part is still under construction. And as you can see here, can reach a region of between 1 and 5 kilometers in diameter. These telescopes are actually radio frequency telescopes and not optical telescopes. And in the final stage, the project will be joined with South Africa, where they built a similar set of array of parabolic antennas. And in the end, we will reach here a distance of 3,000 kilometers of separation. So this will be a huge achievement to improve the resolution of these radio telescopes. In the final chapter, I would like to give you some examples of Bragg diffraction. Bragg diffraction can be used to determine the distances between atoms. 2d sine theta is n equal lambda. Lambda is the incident wavelength, and d is the lattice spacing, the spacing between two atoms. This is actually part of my own research, so I would like to show you what we are doing here. We are determining the symmetry of crystals and also the atomic distances. And here are some nice, beautiful examples of natural crystals. You all know the quartz crystals. And the amazing thing is the atoms order perfectly systematic in form of a crystal lattice. Rock salt, for example, is perfectly cubic. So if you're at home in your kitchen, you can take a magnification lens and look at the salt crystals, and you will see that they are perfectly cubic. So you will see the 90-degree angle everywhere. Here are quartz glass crystals. The size of these crystals can be a couple of centimeters. And the amazing thing is that such a face is really perfectly flat atomic plane. It's really remarkable. Diamond, shown here in the middle. Diamond is basically carbon, but in this form, it forms a cubic crystal lattice. This is a natural diamond, not cut. And what you see here is a 120 degree angle. And this sounds surprising at the first glance, because I just told you that diamond is cubic. So where in a cube is a 120 degree angle? Just think about it. A perfect cube would be 90 degrees on the corners. Where do we have a 120 degree angle? Well, the answer is it's along the body diagonal. Here you see a 120 degree angle. So, amazing thing here is, if you know that, you can already kind of tell people which orientation the crystal structure here has. Two other examples are shown on the right side. Bismuth is funny, as it looks like a cubic structure. However, one of the 90 degree angles is a bit larger. It's 92 degree. And this is a rare case in nature, and in order to compensate for that 92 degree angle, not 90 degree, but 92 degree, the crystal grows in form of a spiral to compensate for that tiny difference in angle. This is nicely shown here for bismuth. So these are natural crystals. Bit deeper look into carbon. Carbon exists in different forms. Diamond, nice and beautiful, shown here. And graphite on the right side. Two completely different types of materials. Diamond is supposed to be the hardest material on the planet and perfectly transparent. The crystal structure is shown below. Perfectly cubic. And on the right side, graphite, which consists of sheets of these honeycomb lattices. The coupling between the lattices is pretty weak. It's just van der Waals forces. So if you touch graphite or simply charcoal, you get immediately black fingers. So these van der Waals bonds are very weak, and you can immediately shear off these honeycomb planes. If you have just one single layer, that would be called graphene. Amazing thing is the layers itself are extremely strong, perfectly elastic, very hard to break. But the bonding between the layers is extremely soft. There are even other forms of diamond, like buckyballs. This is one example of my own research, yttrium titanate. It forms a cluster, a lattice consisting of titanium 06 octahedra. So these octahedra are here shown in yellow color, and the corners are oxygen atoms, and in the center would be a titanium atom. Usually we are using that kind of picture because it's a bit easier to understand. So the building blocks are these titanium 06 octahedra. In general, but that's topic of a future lecture for you, there are different forms of crystal structures: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, monoclinic, triclinic, trigonal, rhombohedral, and finally hexagonal. And in total, if you add all the symmetries together, there are 230 space groups. So crystallography can be quite complicated, but also quite exciting. How can we measure these crystallographic space groups and the atomic distances now? Before I show you what we do at ANSTO, here a photo electron microscopy of a thin film grow which we had grown in our lab. First of all, electron microscopy. That's interesting, because in the lecture I told you that you cannot see atoms with a microscope. To be precise, with an optical microscope. What you see here is every white dot here is a single atom. So you can indeed build a microscope and you can see atoms. And the trick here is we are using electrons and not light, not photons. Electrons as the particle waves. We can build lenses with simply electric fields, and the result is shown here. Electron microscopy, that's the trick, and with that you can actually measure, you can even see atoms. Wavelength here is chosen to be in the range of 1 angstrom, and that's the range of atomic distances. So that's the trick here. So this material was grown with pulsed laser deposition. We have various setups here at the UNSW, 3 in material science and engineering and 1 here in the old main building. And with this trick, you can grow various materials with perfect sharp atomic accuracy. And this is nicely seen here in this picture. Here we have combined a high temperature superconductor, yttrium barium copper oxide, with a ferromagnet, lanthanum calcium manganite. And the aim of that research was to study the interplay between magnetism and superconductivity. But I'm not gonna go deeper here, but what you just see here is the right side, the diagram, how this interface really looks like. We can grow large centimeter-sized perfect single crystals here in our school of physics. And the most sophisticated trick is to use a mirror furnace, where we have 4 parabolic mirrors focused on 1 prepared sample rod, powder sample, and it melts this sample rod. The light is then slowly moved through the rod, and by doing so, the lower part of the rod, of the molten rod, forms a perfect single crystal. So this is at the moment the most sophisticated technique in the world to grow large, high quality single crystals. What we are doing next is diffraction, Bragg's law. We want to determine the crystallographic structure. And this is the photo of my colleagues at ANSTO, the Australian Nuclear Science and Technology Organization, at Lucas Heights, which is about 35-40 minutes car drive from the UNSW. And in the back, you see the research reactor. It's a 20 megawatt nuclear research reactor here underneath this steel tent. This is a look into the neutron guide hall, where you see the different neutron experiments. So at ANSTO, they have 2 powder diffraction instruments, 2 XXX instruments, neutron reflectometry, small angle neutron scattering, lower diffraction, and further instruments. This is how these instruments look like. The 2 big drums in the front are actually small angle neutron scattering. And to achieve extremely small angles, it's again Bragg's law done here. 2D sinus theta is N over lambda. To achieve extremely small angles, the trick is that the detector is placed at 30 meters from the sample. The detector area is about 1 by 1 meter. And just because of the large distance, you can resolve extremely small angles. Why is it in a drum? Well, neutrons get scattered also in air. So That's why these two big vacuum drums are installed to reduce scattering in air. This is one of the high resolution neutron powder diffractometers. The green blocks in the photo, this is actually the neutron guide coming directly from the nuclear reactor. Next to it is the monochromator. It selects out one specific wavelength of the neutrons, let's say 2.7 angstrom, something like that. That's then guided towards the sample stage in the center. The beamline scientist Vanessa here is standing just next to the sample stage. We can apply various electric or magnetic fields, temperatures from 1.5 Kelvin up to 900 Kelvin. So there's a huge parameter space what we can do. And all around, banana-shaped detector, I would call it. This is a detector bank. So the scattering angle, 2d sinus theta, scattering angle, that's all measured in one shot. These detector banks, which are something like more than 120 degree in the very end. The trick is that we have an array of detectors to record the diffraction pattern in one shot. What do we get? This is an example from my own research. In the upper left corner, this is really the diffraction pattern which we got from this powder sample of this material. And you see really nicely the sharp Bragg peaks now. So this picture proves two things. It first of all proves, yes, we have a single crystal, but it also proves that neutrons behave like particle waves. Without wave properties, we would not be able to detect such a diffraction pattern. Neutrons are for sure particles. They have a mass of 1.675 times 10 to the power of minus 27 kilogram. They are for sure particles, but as the Broglie wavelength tells us, they also have wave properties. And the wave property is used here and shown here. Without the wave properties of neutrons, neutron powder diffraction would not be possible. So that's the diffraction pattern here. By the way, the black line is the fitting of our crystal structure model, and the blue line underneath is the difference between the measured data and our fitted model. What we then do is temperature dependency, and what you see on the right side is change in lattice parameters. You know that under the keyword thermal expansion. Neutron itself also carries a magnetic moment, and that's why we can also measure the magnetism inside a sample. And here, if you look at the contour plot at QA, at a very low QA value of 1.1, there's a Bragg peak which disappears at about 175 Kelvin, and that's the magnetic phase transition. So using the magnetic moment of a neutron, we can also do magnetic Bragg diffraction to determine the magnetic structure. And this is also shown here in this diagram. So this is what we can do with neutron diffraction. This experiment was done at ANSTO here in Sydney. Another setup at ANSTO is Laue diffraction. And here I did put a different crystal, terbium Mn205. It's quite complicated crystal structure, but the base structure is cubic again. We did put that crystal here into the Laue diffraction setup and in two different crystal orientations along the 100 and the 001 axis, so two different orientations. And you really nicely see the symmetry of the crystal. The first striking feature is a 90 degree angle in both pictures. But if you have a closer look on the left side, the diagonal is not perfectly 45 degree, but 56 degree. That's an indication for another crystal axis. On the right hand side is different. Here we have the perfect diagonal located at 45 degree. So even by looking at such Lowell pictures, you immediately learn a lot about the crystal symmetry of your sample in the beam. So this is an example for neutron Lowell diffraction. Once again, it proves that you have a beautiful single crystal, and it would also not be possible if neutrons would not behave like particle waves. And finally, here just a sketch of this experimental setup. So a relatively simple one with an area detector, incoming beam on the sample. So relative simple setup, and the illumination time to record such a pattern was 2 minutes. So that's the end of this section. I hope you got some useful information for a deeper understanding of what we had discussed in the lecture. Thank you very much.